One fateful day near the end of the 21st century, disaster struck, and the world was plunged into an unending amount of chaos. The lives of billions were taken during this catastrophe, but humanity was not wiped out completely. At the end of the 21st century, most of the Earth was rendered uninhabitable. Since then, this major catastrophic event was named Cataclysm. The cause of the cataclysm is unknown. Though most people thought that the end was near, not all hope was lost. Since five megacorporations had a plan to revamp human society and bring it into a new era, the true agendas of each party were vastly different. Could any of their ideals bring true, unending tranquility and innovation? Are their motives really in the best interests of the people? Or is there something lying in the shadows of goodwill? At the start of the cataclysm, there was one megacorporation that was ready to make a move. They were known as SpaceTech, one of the major transnational Earth corporations. They were focused mostly on space-related operations, but they also had branches in fields such as automotive and aircraft industries, robotic, heavy machinery, and many more. Their first colony on the Red Planet was established on July 28th, 2084, and because they arrived the soonest on Mars, they gained many huge advantages compared to the rest. One of the advantages was that they were able to select the best locations for their colonies. And until this day, SpaceTech colonies are very reminiscent of Earth's. Its political system are still similar to the classic Western democracy, and its economy is one of regulated capitalism. Back on Earth, there was one corporation which was the leader on the global security and private military markets. This megacorporation is known as DSC. Although DSC was the second corporation to evacuate Earth, the journey to the Red Planet was not an easy one. A mutiny broke out on one of the DSC arcs as a result of the cramped conditions, forced labor, and rationed food. The mutiny spurred the DSC leadership, which had already imposed fairly strict rule on its arcs, to establish a truly militarized society with iron discipline and rigid totalitarian control over the colonist behavior. Their first colony was established on August 12, 2085. This regime persisted. The DSC colonies consist of enormous militarized cities beneath impenetrable energy domes. Travel between cities is highly restricted and the dome's exits are closely monitored. To leave the colony, one needs permission from a special agency called the Oversight Committee. The committee oversees not just the colonists' movement, but all aspects of their lives. What they do, their resource consumption, who they communicate with, what their interests are, and many other things. The rules and obligations that the Oversight Committee established are so strict and hard to follow that many people find it quite hard to live in DSC colonies. Icarus Technologies was once the first name that came to mind when talking about robotics, telecommunications, and other computer technologies. It was the company responsible for most of the robots and AIs used in all spheres, from heavy industry to day-to-day life. Yet the exodus to Mars hit them hard. They arrived on Mars a whole year too late, after all good territories had already come under the control of either DSC or SpaceTech, and so Icarus Technologies colonists were forced to settle in an area near the South Pole of Mars with its harsh climate and long polar nights. Icarus settlements are small and spread out quite far from one another, and due to the harsh weather conditions, traveling between colonies is extremely difficult. That's why the average resident of an Icarus Technologies colony spends most of their life in virtual reality. It is impossible to function in this society without access to the Soul Network and virtual reality. All Icarus citizens above the age of 15 are equipped with the necessary augmentation to function in virtual reality. Other types of implants and augmentations are also commonplace. One day, will all Icarus citizens never be able to experience reality? From the moment they are born, we won't know yet, but we will find out one day. Evolution is evil life. That was the company's slogan back in the day. Evil Life and its subsidiaries were the acknowledged leader of the biotechnology, genetic engineering, high-tech farming, and chemical industries. The company's labs conducted groundbreaking research in genetics and biology, and many of those inventions were soon put into mass production. Their first colony on the Red Planet was established on March 13th, 2087, the latest of all the colonies. When the cataclysm hit, Evo Life took a different path from all the other colonies. They just sent a small group of pioneers to Mars to establish a colony, while creating sanctuaries on Earth where people could live safe from the cataclysm's repercussions. Later, they placed all sanctuary inhabitants on arcs and evacuated them to a cave system deep in the Noctis Labyrinthus, where bearable living conditions had already been prepared for them. The way Evo Life manages their society today is, let's say, objective-based. Each person has a specific role, and they are modified to be hyper-specific for their particular role. Many people love the system, but others despise it. People who rebel are exiled from the colony in the end. Considering these things, will people still resemble humans in the near future? Will biotechnology have advanced so much that the creation of so many other creatures be possible? Who knows? Who knows? Yandi Ventures is a finance and energy conglomerate. Back on Earth, their main focus was the financial market, where the company utterly dominated. But they also invested heavily into cutting-edge energy research, which paid off. When the cataclysm hit, they created the Yandi Station, which was both an arc and an orbital station. Instead of landing on Mars and fighting for the scarce territory there, the Yandi board decided to stay in space, on the station, orbiting the Red Planet. First colony on Mars orbit was on December 25th, 2086. The key to Yandi Ventures' survival is its monopoly over the most effective energy production technology to date. The technology is stored in utmost secrecy. The Yandi Ventures agents do everything they can to prevent leaks. The process itself is managed by the Board of Directors, a committee consisting of Yandi's richest and most powerful families, who were the backbone of this organization even on their home planet, Earth. As decades went by, these megacorporations saw how valuable the last resources on their dying home planet were, and of course, they wanted it for themselves. On top of not having good ties with one another, there were many smaller groups of individuals who also wanted a piece of the pie. Because of these differences, huge mechs were created, also due to the fact that travel on Mars was very hard compared to Earth. These mechs were known as robots, and they are used in multiple different fields. Mainly, they were used for war and battle against other mechs or parties involved in the resource-gathering race on Earth. Many tales were told during this period, some of you may know and others completely unknown. Some examples of these tales are the tales of Thomas Mindred, or the tragedies that occurred on Icarus Station A87N. Many people were using illegal and dirty tricks to get their hands on whatever they want, or to spread their point or ideals across. How can we tell who is really telling the truth, or whose ideals are really in the interests of the greater good? Now we have come to today. The year is 2142 and it is currently an era of sub-peace between all the colonies. Earth has become a huge battleground for bounty hunters and proxy mercenaries. This is where you come in, Commander. This is now your story. You have a chance to shape the future and change it for the better or worse. I salute you, Commander, for your courage, bravery, and will to continue fighting, striving, and not just surviving but thriving in this post-apocalyptic Martian era we exist in. The true objectives and goals of each megacorporation and individual pilot or commander will still remain unknown, but that's what makes every day interesting, right? And that's how the War Robots universe began and continues today.